We're very glad to be with you tonight, that you're here with us. So always get good when brethren dwell.
Amen.
Dwell.
Yes. Uh-huh.
Together in unity.
Amen.
Dwell together in unity. We welcome those who have joined us in live stream also. We appreciate your presence. We're going to be in the Gospel of John again. This will be our 72nd exposition of this book. We're going to be in chapter 6, verses 10 through 13. This, as you know, is the incident of the feeding of the 5,000. It's a host of people, 5,000 men, beside women and children. Now, if only half of the men were married, and each family had two children, that'd be 12,500. So, and if there were 5,000 families of four, that'd be 20,000. So this gives you an idea of the number of people that could very well have been there. Any way you look at it, it's a lot of people. About half as many people as live in Joplin. Now, these are people to be fed.
Yeah.
We don't overlook. It's just in a crowd. This is a crowd to be fed.
Amen.
And in the world, that would be a setup for pandemonium.
Yeah.
Now, ordinarily, in this many people being fed, someone would be overlooked or ignored, or somebody would be despised. It's unlikely that everybody would be fed. And this kind of people is a gravitation to disorder,
yes,
and to a possible discord and chaos. It kind of tends in that, you get a lot of people got tends in that direction. But there's no record of anything like this happening at this time. Seems to be like a perfect control of this mass of people. It seems to be like a perfect control. We kind of learn here that where there's submission to Jesus, there is order.
Yes, amen.
Amen.
That'll happen. A lack of order is always indication of a lack of submission to Christ. Because Christ is the Prince of Peace. Anyone subjects to him, they're not going to be causing trouble. That's for sure. Also, it's just going to be a few people that serve all these people. 12. Few people going to serve all these people. See, that doesn't match up too well either. That equals to a mass amount of time,
yeah,
under ordinary circumstances. And everybody's going to eat from the same supply. Like the people that Israel ate manna, the same supply, all these people. See, so there's no indication of like finicky appetites. That's kind of a 20th century phenomenon among people that are living on top of the hog, you know.
Yeah, yeah. Amen.
The rest of the world, they're not finicky like that.
Uh-huh.
Strange, isn't it, that it's harder to be satisfied when you have a lot?
Uh-huh.
In the flesh, I'm talking about.
Right.
Now, truth, like these loaves and fishes, can be served to a multitude of people at the same time. See, that's another interesting thing to see. This, you didn't break it up into time segments, 8 to 9 is this group, 9 to 10, that's how the world would do it. They did it at the same time, all of them did it.
Amen.
And they all have different capacities. This would create a lot of problems. From infants to old people, you know, present quite a few problems. When properly declared, truth also accomplishes what this food did here. Everybody's going to be fed from the same supply. They're all going to be satisfied. No one's going to complain about the meal.
Yeah.
Any complaints leveled later will not be because of this meal.
That's right.
Those are proper motives. They'll be made known at this time, as well as those of the proper ones. Now, truth, like the loaves, are not tailored for men or women or children. See, there's food for adults, food for children. See, there's different kinds of food. But this is one kind of food.
That's right.
Amen. Being served for everybody, like truth. There's times when certain words are delivered to certain people, like it will occur in this text here, but when it comes to feeding, all the words came from the same one, same supply, same speech. Jesus is always a shepherd that feeds.
Amen.
That's part of a shepherd's duty,
yes.
Feed. He always taught the people, always taught the people,
Amen.
Leaving them with no alternative to leave without knowing more. When you're around Jesus, you learn more.
Yes, amen.
Your knowledge base is increased. If people remain in a relatively ignorant state, and this is a condition that, my goodness, it surely exists in our country. I found it exists in other countries too. There's either they weren't taught by Jesus, or Jesus was there and they didn't know it, or they didn't care for what Jesus said.
Uh-huh. Yeah.
That's the only explanation for something like this. Now, like this, in this environment of feeding, that's the kind of environment salvation is ministered in a feeding. I mean, you examine the conversions in Scripture, and there was food being served, spiritual food being served up when the people were converted. And our text is John 10, verse 10, John 6, verse 10 through 13. And Jesus said, "Make the men sit down." Now there was much grass in the place, so the people sat down. The men sat down, in number about 5,000. And Jesus took the loaves, and when he had given thanks, he distributed to the disciples, and the disciples to them that were set down, and likewise to the fishes, as much as they would. When they were filled, he said unto his disciples, "Gather up the fragments that remain, that there be that nothing be lost." Therefore they gathered them together and filled 12 baskets with the fragments of 5 barley loaves, which had remained over and above unto them that had eaten.
Yeah.
Rather simplistic, isn't it? When you read it, it's just no fanfare, you know.
No.
And no stage with a lot of announcements and a lot of spotlights, you know.
Mm-hmm.
Just proceeded, seated on.
Amen.
Because Jesus, his person, gets the attention.
Yeah.
Yes.
Yeah. Amen.
The men have to create an attention getting an atmosphere, they think anyway. All right, so they've discovered a supply of food, small for one adult. It was small for one adult. 5 loaves and 2 fishes. This is what Jesus is going to use now. I mean, do you really think some little tidbit of truth that you know, that you, if you said it, do you really think Jesus could feed the rest of us with it? You know, think no more.
Yeah,
yes,
that's right.
He can. Jesus said, "Now make the men sit down."
Mm-hmm.
Activity's got to stop now. We're going to feed. This is no time to be walking around. In recent years, it's fashionable, and in some churches, people are walking around during the service.
Yeah. Mm-hmm.
Some of you have attended meetings at places like that. They're actually walking around during the meeting.
Mm-hmm.
But when the time comes to feed, make the men sit down.
Yeah. Mm-hmm.
Matthew says he commanded the multitude to sit on the grass. Everybody sat down. Mark says he commanded them to make all sit down by companies upon green grass. They sat down in ranks by hundreds and fifties.
Mm-hmm.
That it made it easier to feed them.
Mm-hmm.
groups of hundreds and groups of 50s. They must have had some talk going on in there, I would imagine. Now here we're going to see how the kingdom of God operates. God's at the top of the kingdom governing it. This was depicted in Jacob's dream of the ladder set up on earth, top reached to heaven, and that on the top, at the top of the, over the ladder, God was there. He's orchestrating the whole affair. The ladder set up on earth is God's doing something on earth.
That's right.
Amen.
See, that's what's happening here.
Yeah.
God's doing something. And angels were ascending and descending, carrying out his man. This is how God works now. God governs. There's a means set up to communicate with the people down on earth, and then people speak for him to people on the earth. This is how God operates. Yeah. There's no direct communication between God and the people. That's how holy God is. It's always through somebody. Always. The ultimate messenger, of course, is Jesus. Previous people he spoke through was Moses. God gave the law, he gave it to Moses, and Moses gave it to the people. God had a message for the people, he gave it to the prophets, prophets gave it to the people. Me? God had to prepare the way for Jesus. He gave the word to John the Baptist. John the Baptist told the people. See, this is the way God sent Jesus. Jesus told the people. See, this is how God works. So someone that thinks they've had instant communication with God, they don't understand. This is not even the way God works. You say, what about when he spoke to people in the old scriptures? Well, it was through angels. Sometimes he'll make that quite clear to you, that God himself directly doesn't talk to anybody on earth. He couldn't. If God speaks, the earth almost falls apart. If God just shows up, the earth almost falls apart, like it did at Sinai. So this is how you got to see things. Someone says, God told me. That's very impressive. If God did, now you got to tell it, and then we'll test it, see whether it.
Amen.
Because if God did tell you something, it's intended that you tell it to those other people. That's how God operates. He tells it to someone, somebody tell it to the people. Jesus is going to feed this multitude, but he's going to do it through the disciples.
I was impressed by this, men. I can see how they would have set this up. They would have said, well, the men, we don't want them to sit down. We want them to come up. There'll be a representative of each family come, and we'll give it to him. But that isn't how he did it.
Yes,
he gave it to the apostles, the disciples, and then demonstrating here in your thing. This has got to be seen, because otherwise it was not a free-for-all. It's like, what do you want to do? What do you think we should do?
See, there's a lot of nebulous concepts about God that exist in the church.
Amen.
They just don't know how God operates. And so these accounts here are illustrating to us how God works. God's got a message to give to the churches. Jesus does. Jesus gives it to an angel, and the angel gives it to John. John gives it to the churches. This is how it works. This is how God works. Don't expect to hear God's voice talking to you personally. It'd be through an angel. That's how he gave the law. The law was given through the disposition of angels. It sounded, there was a voice like to scare the people to death, but it wasn't God's personal voice. It was God speaking through angels. The angels was given by the law was given by the disposition of angels. It was ordained by angels in the hands of a mediator. See, so this is taught. It's not guesswork.
Amen.
In Scripture. Thing to see here is that sin has formed an impassable gulf between God and man.
Yes, amen.
The passage has got to be from heaven to here. It can't be from here to heaven.
Yeah.
Amen. That's how the passage. God, amen. The passage has got to be instituted in heaven. It can't be instituted on earth.
Yeah.
Amen. So if a person comes along with a nice fancy program to help people recover and so forth, says, I've used this program, you'll yet find your way to God. This is just a bunch of baloney.
Yeah.
It's not true. Just discard it, throw it in the garbage can. The way to God is instituted in heaven.
Yes.
And God tells people what it is.
Amen. And this, some people rebel against that, what you just said. Some people will say, now wait a minute. I did quit smoking with that program. But that just proves that you can quit smoking without God.
That's right.
That means you can You can rule over your own body.
That's right. There's a lot of people quit smoking, quit drinking, quit taking drugs that are atheists.
That's it.
You don't have to have God to do that. Don't say, I couldn't have done this without God. You could have done it on your own in the flesh. You could have done it. There's been people that have.
That's right.
Don't say you couldn't.
Right.
There's been people that have. But what God asked you to do,
huh?
That's something else, because that's dealing with your heart.
That's right.
Not with controlling a habit. That's not what spiritual life. Spiritual life is a controlling a habit that keeps popping up.
Yeah.
That's not what it is.
That's right.
Amen.
Spiritual life is a communion between you and the living God.
Amen.
And it's set up by God.
Yes.
Now, as we said, God, Jesus is the ultimate spokesman for God. Hebrews 1:2 says that God hath in these last days spoken unto us by his sons. He says, it's plain. Jesus said to his disciples, peace be unto you as my Father has sent me, even so I send you. See, this is how God operates now, see?
Yeah.
So now in this new covenant era, if you want something from God, you have got to get it through Jesus.
Amen.
You can't get it through Muhammad.
That's right.
You can't. I don't care what people say, you can't. The appointed messenger, master messenger is Jesus, and the only people that have the message are the people he sends. How can they preach except they be sent?
That's right.
Not sent by men, sent by God. So I'm showing here the principle, how the kingdom of God operates, so to speak. What divine wisdom is made known, the divine wisdom made known is the employed to communicate to men. So when God makes from heaven makes known truth or a wisdom or a fact, it's in order that it might be made known to the rest of the people.
Yeah.
It's not private, like just for the person. There's not messages like that. The most notable men in history, like Moses, what he received had to be given up to others. It wasn't just for Moses.
That's right. Yeah.
The prophets, it wasn't just for the prophets. John the Baptist, it wasn't just for John the Baptist, it's for the people. This is how God operates, see? Now let's say that there's such a thing as a church that's cultured to be insensitive to God. People in this, whatever group of people it is, they don't live for God. They haven't presented their bodies a living sacrifice to God. They really don't know anything about God. Whatever ideas they have are bogus. It's got to come from Christ. And you've got to be connected with Christ to get what Christ has. See?
Yeah. Amen.
That's how the kingdom of God works. Now you think about when Jesus came to earth. There had been certain routines that God had set in motion that had to do with approaching him. They were very exacting and precise routines. Sacrifices, what kind of sacrifices, when they were to be offered, what you were to do with the sacrifice, if it was consumed, if it wasn't consumed. It's very precise routines. But none of them changed people. It just kept them from being consumed. That's all it did. So Jesus now, with his introduction, now we enter into a new era. This era is not to control men.
Yeah.
This era is not to get people to change. That's not what the era of salvation is. Okay, so, but you'd be surprised, almost all the ministries of an average church are those kind of ministries. Almost all of them. That's the kind of ministries they are. That's not why Jesus came.
Yeah.
Jesus came to settle this rift man has with God.
Amen.
To address that problem, get the bottleneck, which was sin, out of the way, take it away. Open up a new and living way to God, not to one another, to God. That's what salvation is all about. It's demonstrated here in this text. If this moment would have come to the 12 disciples with, and Jesus wasn't there, the 12 disciples couldn't have fed him.
Mm-hmm. That's right.
They just had to go home hungry. The disciples knew this.
Yeah.
They understood this.
Yeah, but you know, there's a big difference between change and being made new.
That's exactly
he
right.
He didn't like to polish up the old man.
Yeah.
It's got to go so we can have this new and living way.
See, there's people that this is how they think. Maybe I thought this way myself when I was younger. But the important thing is to live different. Live in a different way. Learn to control your habits. You see, there's all kind of career. Man, people built careers on this.
Uh-huh.
There's gigantic financial empires built on this. Correcting behavior in the name of Christ.
Yeah.
There are a dime a dozen. They're all over the place. If you were to look them up on internet, you'll be studying for a long time because they're in the thousands.
Uh-huh.
But this is not what Jesus came to do.
Yeah.
God had the solution for getting people to stop sinning.
Yeah.
Take their life.
Yeah.
That's what the law did.
Yeah, that's right. Yeah.
That's what the law did.
Uh-huh.
And that's what Jesus does.
Yeah, that's right.
He takes your life.
Amen.
That part of you has to die.
Yes.
Has to be crucified.
Amen.
And then when that's done, you're not... That's when the change is wrought.
Yes, amen.
Make the people sit down. And it's a little incident, incidental remark he makes. There was much grass in the place.
Mm-hmm.
It was commodious, you
yes.
know. Now, this isn't in the heart of the city. This is outside in a deserted place. Deserted mean it doesn't mean desert. It just means there wasn't cultivated fields net out there. Much grass is in the place. Now, by way of comparison, when the law was given, there wasn't much grass in a place.
Yeah.
It was on Mount Sinai and Horeb, a rocky place.
Yeah.
It wasn't commodious.
Mm-hmm.
And when Moses went up, it was a rocky place. When Elijah went to Mount Horeb, there was rocks all over the place that were split apart when a great devastated wind came through. See, it wasn't... When the law was given, the place it was given wasn't like a resort.
Yeah. Uh-huh.
It wasn't a common resting place, not Mount Horeb and Mount Sinai in particular. It was a different kind of place. But this is a picture of the way where Christ feeds you is in a comfortable place.
Yeah,
amen.
Where you're away from the affairs of the world and your spirit is settled down. That's when Jesus ministers. Yes.
I was also considering how it's a place of plenty. There's
plenty,
of,
that's right.
Had sheep would be a place where they would be able to get their fill.
Yeah.
And it's in a sense like a parable of what Jesus was going to do. They're in a place of plenty, and there was going to be plenty for them to have their fill as well.
Yes, amen.
Uh-huh.
Amen. There's much grass in the place. So Mount Sinai was a barren place like the hearts of men, you know,
yeah.
by nature. But when Jesus gets ready to minister, it's in a plush, spiritual place. So the men sat down. Now in Scripture, men didn't eat while they were running or walking. They stopped to eat. They sat there as they were being fed. See, at the disciples at the Last Supper, they sat down. When Martha made a supper for Jesus, the people sat down. The four gospel writers all record this event, affirming that about 5,000 sat down.
Amen.
When you get ready to hear from Jesus, you got to disengage your heart and mind. You got to disengage it from the world.
Mm-hmm.
It has to be done. That's one reason why we sing songs and pray and just assist us in disengaging, cutting loose.
Yeah.
Sometime maybe you've been... involved in kind of activities, nothing wrong with the activities, so something had to be done, but it was like draining, it was kind of like a draining to you. Well, you all know this. Yes.
I'm reminded of Mary and Martha when Jesus was in the house. Mary was sitting at Jesus' feet, listening to him, and Martha was up and about doing the things that were required for there to be a meal, She was doing those things, but she wasn't. She didn't choose the better part.
That's right.
That was disengaging what was still necessary, but not as important at the moment because Jesus was talking.
That's right. Mm-hmm. Now, I've noticed that early on, humans tend to daydream. Young people, we used to call it spaced out. They tend to be this way. But when you're dealing with salvation, things that pertain to life and godliness and being taught by Christ, this is not the time for that, for daydreaming. Yeah, right. And for your mind kind of being floating around in inactivity. It's the time to eat. They sat down not to sleep. Uh-huh. They sat down to eat. Mark says, now these people, they've been pretty busy. When they saw Jesus come to this place, remember they come out from all cities all around and ran, made a trip. I don't know how far the trip was, but we're talking in terms of miles. Ran to be with Jesus. Then he healed their sick and talked to them of the kingdom of God for a better part of the day. So these were, you know, there'd been a lot of activity going on. Amen. Traveled some distance to be there. Mm-hmm. And now they sit down. And the meal is going to compensate for their weariness.
Yeah.
They're going to be strengthened, see, by eating. Now, this was not the manner of the people at Sinai. They were moved to fear. They asked, they said, don't have God speak to us anymore. Moses, you talk to us.
Yeah.
See, the circumstance was different.
Yeah, that's right.
When the law was given, everyone was scared.
Mm-hmm.
And they couldn't stand to hear a voice coming from heaven.
Mm-hmm.
Now in Christ, the whole situation changes. Now people are anxious to hear from heaven. There's coming another time when there's going to be a mass gathering of the people. Jacob prophesied it to Judah, saying, to him, the Messiah, shall the gathering of the people be.
Mm-hmm.
Jesus talked about drawing all men to him. The prophets talked about the knowledge of the Lord covering the earth as the waters cover the sea.
Mm-hmm.
That is in time, toward the close of time,
mm-hmm.
there's going to be a mass coming to Christ that dwarfs anything that's happened before.
Yeah.
And the knowledge of the Lord is going to cover the earth as the waters cover the sea. Mm-hmm. We're getting a prelude of it here. Jesus' earthly ministry is like a prelude to it. First fruit. Pentecost was the first harvest. It's the first fruit harvest.
Mm-hmm.
It was nothing compared to what the latter harvest.
Yeah.
The latter harvest, the main one. Now this is my opinion. This is why worldly population is exploding exponentially. Now we're pushing 7 billion. And less than a year ago, we just barely passed 6 billion.
Mm-hmm.
So all of a sudden, there's an exponential increase of people.
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm.
Now, here's a world people say, how are we going to feed them? See, that's a... But God's thinking of converting them.
Yeah.
Amen.
But to do that, he's going to have people
mm-hmm.
that will faithfully represent him to these multitudes of people. And he doesn't have very many of those kind of people right now. Percentage-wise, but he will. So we're looking forward. We're looking forward to this time when the knowledge of the Lord covers the earth as the waters cover the sea, and the waters do cover the sea.
Mm-hmm.
The knowledge of the Lord does not presently cover the earth.
Yeah.
There's patches of it here, here and there. There's little wells here and there, and even that's not everywhere. But the knowledge of the Lord will yet cover the earth as the waters cover the sea, and it will be a circumstance just like this. Jesus will not come to the people. The people will come to him.
Uh-huh. Yeah.
Hmm? John the Baptist didn't come to the people.
Yeah.
The people came to him.
That's right.
Amen.
Jesus didn't go to the people.
Mm-hmm.
The people went to him. See, this is how God's going to work. In the end, no one's going to have any question about who did this.
Yeah.
No institution is going to be able to rise up and say, We did this. They all used our program. No one's going to be able to say that. Just like no one could take the credit for the feeding of this multitude but Jesus. That's the only person. Nobody else could do it. So Jesus, now the people are set down. They're in a position now to be fed. Yes.
That's an interesting point that we should take note of, is that men are the ones being drawn.
That's right.
When God did say this, he said that no man comes to him unless the Father first draws him. But yeah, you don't hear anything about Jesus being drawn to men. So I mean, I think if Jesus was actually out seeking, that he would be the one that would justify be doing the directing, being directed. But it says men are being drawn to him.
And he finds and brings, who he goes to seek, he finds and brings home.
That's right.
There were cases in Scripture where Jesus went someplace. The Syrophoenician woman, he went up there to Tyre and Sidon where she was. He came to her. Jairus, he came to there. He came to her. See, there were instances the Gadarene demoniac Jesus came to. Mm-hmm. Most of the time, though, people came to him.
Yeah.
Mm-hmm. Now, notice the authority with which Jesus speaks in Acts. This stands out to me. He just has absolute command of the situation. What do you have? 5 loaves and 2 fishes. Bring them to me. Make the people sit down. He's speaking with his absolute tone of authority, effective authority. Yes, Brother Aaron.
I was going to say about the grass in the place. It makes me think of Jesus being the shepherd. He leads
green pastures.
Jesus is also a captain.
That's right.
So there's also a table spread in the midst of enemies.
In the presence of enemies.
Yes.
Nourishment doesn't only happen in quiet, lush.
That's right.
Uh-huh. It also happens in the heat of the battle.
That's right.
Mm-hmm. Amen.
Yeah.
Yeah, that's generally like a private meal. But I can remember when I first saw that. My goodness, when was that? I think in the late 50s. And I burst on me one day, and there was a person that was aggravating me. And I said to him, "Excuse me while I sit down at the table."
Yeah.
I'm going to sit down there. Lord prepares me a table in the presence of my enemies. Pardon me, for I'm going to take a snack now and be nourished. Mm-hmm. I knew that from when I was just 3-4 years old. I could quote the 23rd Psalm, but when I saw what it meant, well. Now see, the word says, the scriptures tell us that Christ's word was with power.
Yeah.
So you can tell how much authority a person has by what happens by his speech. Mm-hmm. What he can make happen just by his word. That'll tell you how much authority they got.
Yeah, that's right.
So he just said things. He didn't repeat it. You notice none of this stuff was repeated.
That's right.
He just said it once, and that was it. His words with power. Mm-hmm. Then Jesus took the loaves. He took them. Remember when they told him, there was a lad there with 5 loaves and 2 fishes. Matthew reports, he said, "Bring them hither to me." Or we'd say, "Bring them here to me." Mm-hmm. He didn't say, "Where are they at? I'll go get them." He didn't.
Yeah.
Bring them to me.
Yeah. Uh-huh.
See that authoritative word? Bring them to me. No one asked why.
Mm-hmm.
No one said why. What are you going to do with just that stuff very much? He didn't. No questions. They just did what he said.
Yeah.
Bring them to me. That's what he does when you present your. See, he says to you about your bodies.
Yeah.
Bring them to me.
That's right.
See?
Amen.
Present your bodies a living sacrifice to God. Bring them to him like the disciples brought those loaves. Bring them. He could come and pick you up by the nape of the neck or by the hair of the head like he did the prophet. Mm-hmm. Ezekiel, by the hair of the head, and transported him to another place. Kind of an uncomfortable way to be transported. But he said, bring it to me. Bring that body to me. And what does he do when this is God manifest in the flesh now? This is the one that made the fish. This is the one that made the grain from which the bread came. So if anyone shouldn't have to give thanks, it'd be him. He's the creator, but he gives thanks.
Yeah.
He gives thanks. Matthew reports, looking up to heaven, he blessed and broke the laws.
Yeah.
Looking up to heaven. Mm-hmm. He made a way for us, but he had a way. See,
yeah.
All right.
Yeah. Amen.
Already. Mark reports the same thing. He looked up to heaven and he blessed it and broke it. At the Last Supper, remember he took the bread and he blessed it and broke it. And then he took the cup and blessed it also. When Paul urged the people on a storm-tossed sea to eat, you remember he told them, give them 14 days, you haven't eaten, you're weak now. When the ship's going to be dashed upon a rock, we're all going to have to make it to the shore. So you're going to have to eat something, get strength.
Yeah.
And so he, Acts 27:35, he took bread and gave thanks to God in the presence of them all.
Yeah.
See? That's why we pray before we eat. It's not just because it's a custom.
Yeah, that's right. Amen.
Jesus lived out the doctrine of how we're to eat.
Mm-hmm.
Now, the doctrine contradicts some professed health experts.
Mm-hmm.
But I'd rather them have the red face.
Yeah.
Huh?
Mm-hmm.
Here's the doctrine. Now, there were... Some people would teach people to command to abstain from meats which God hath created to be received with thanksgiving of them that believe and know the truth.
Mm-hmm.
For every, this is 1 Timothy 4:3. For every, or maybe we shouldn't read it. This is too incriminating to the dietitians, huh?
Yeah.
This is, I'll read it.
Yeah.
Every creature of God is good and nothing to be refused, parenthesis, even if it's a bottom feeder.
Yeah, that's right. Yep.
Mm-hmm.
If it be received with thanksgiving.
Yeah, that's right.
Yes. It is sanctified by the word of God and prayer.
Yeah. Amen.
Amen.
Praise God.
Yeah.
The thing that makes it eatable is the word of God,
yes,
cleansing it,
yep,
and prayer, sanctifying it. That's the thing that makes it. That purifies and consecrates it. No matter what men say. Now, I understand you don't eat something that you know is poison, like the poison pot, you remember?
Yeah.
That the sons of the prophets, they stole Elijah, said the food's poison, we can't eat it.
Yeah.
But they could tell that by taste, not by reading the document. They could tell it by taste. He said, well, take a handful of meal, throw it in there, and it'll be all right. And they ate from it anyway.
Mm-hmm.
I don't want to be... unduly distracted by the wisdom of men and theorizing about what people should eat and what they shouldn't eat, which people are always telling us what we should eat and what we shouldn't eat. I just got to speak for myself. I just don't listen to them. I don't listen to them.
Mm-hmm.
I got the word of the Creator on this.
Yeah.
It doesn't make you foolish or naive.
Mm-hmm.
Jesus took the loaves and he blessed them. He didn't say, Who baked these bread,
yeah,
this bread? And what kind of grain did they use?
Yeah.
Was it a natural grain? Or what about these fish? Where did you catch these fish? Was it a clean one? Or what? How did you prepare them? See, he didn't. It's sanctified by the word of God and,
yes,
word of God and prayer. Now, when I've traveled abroad, I followed this. I didn't know. I went places I had no idea sometimes what I was eating. I didn't know. And sometimes when I knew, I said, whoa, you got to have some grace to do this. But I made an agreement with God, I'll eat. What, if they can eat it,
yeah,
I can eat it. That's, and I will eat it. But I prayed and sanctified it.
That's right.
Yeah.
Amen.
And I never had adverse effects from eating on foreign soil. I'm not condemning or judging anyone that has. Understand, I'm speaking just for myself, that's all. But I am saying that you can believe that word.
Mm-hmm.
It's sanctified by the word of God and prayer. You may know tonight what you're eating, but you may be in a situation where you have no idea what you're eating,
mm-hmm,
or what the potential of that hurting you is. But you can depend on God.
Mm-hmm.
Amen.
Amen.
And it's sanctified by the word of God. All things are to be received and nothing refused. That's what,
yeah,
he said now.
Yeah.
And prayer.
Mm-hmm.
I'm working for you, Lord. I'm living for you. I'm praying you'll protect me.
Mm-hmm.
Pray this for your children too. You don't know sometimes when they're away what they eat. Pray it for them too.
Mm-hmm.
Yes.
Also, thankfulness is sort of like a seasoning too. It makes eating more pleasurable when you're thankful for what you're eating.
Oh, yes.
And this is true spiritually as well.
Amen.
You receive spiritual nourishment with thanksgiving.
Yes.
It makes the receiving of the truth a pleasurable experience.
Yeah. And, amen.
And this spiritual food should be sanctified by the word of God in
That's
prayer.
Right. Amen.
Sanctify the word of God. God should be the preeminent person who's commented about whatever we're talking about.
Mm-hmm.
His word should be the preeminent word on it. And then we, by prayer,
mm-hmm.
we make the thing suitable for us to ingest.
Yes.
Brother Jonathan.
When you mentioned that word, it sounds like there could be times where you don't know what you're eating, like you're not sure if it's harmful or not, but because you sanctified it,
mm-hmm.
it won't hurt you.
That's exactly
now,
what he's saying.
That does remind me, Jesus did say here, he says, if they drink any deadly thing, it shall not hurt them.
That's right.
So I don't know if that's really what's involved
but he did say that. Yeah, they didn't intentionally drink it.
Right.
Yeah, yeah.
That's
yeah.
the idea. They weren't, they didn't know. See,
right.
now you may know now.
Right.
You may, you're living in a time when you may know what you're eating all the time, but this may not always be the case. This may not always be the case, but this that we've read, it is always the case. That is sanctified by the word of God in prayer.
Hey, Brother Gibbon, I can even remember as a young man watching how people ate, and they would give thanks, but then they would complain the whole time that they didn't like that food. They would rather not have. And I remember thinking, that's kind of like a contradiction, isn't
yeah.
it?
Yeah.
You just asked God, you said you were thankful for it, now you just throw it back in his face. But anyway, that was just a...
Yeah, well, they weren't like my father used to tell me, you're just not hungry enough. So my mother put the plate up and I'd have to eat it later.
Yeah.
That very plate,
yeah.
yeah. That's how my mother handled it.
Yeah.
asking no questions
for conscience sake.
Yeah.
Also apply to having fellowship.
That's right.
With people, rather don't be overly concerned with what's your background or
that's right. Amen.
Who are you associated with?
That's right.
If it's from the Lord, then receive it.
Now this is confusing. Recently, I've had discussions with people. This is confusing. They've heard something. They know it's truth, but they didn't come from the right background, so it created all kind of questions. Just.
We can make the parallel to spiritual things, but now this is a good word
for
the saints, because you know you listen to men that can run you crazy.
Oh.
You read these things, buy foods you should never buy.
Yeah, I know.
Stuff like this, you know, but you've got a word.
Got a word.
The Lord said you can eat anything.
Yeah,
that's right.
You know, according to you know.
We understand he's talking about natural things.
Sure.
He's not talking about men's artificial foods, but
yeah,
this is stuff God created.
Yeah.
Uh-huh. And well, you can bank on him. You can. Yes. You can bank on him to come through here, sanctified by the word of God and prayer.
Mm-hmm.
Yes.
Amen. There are some people today that are they're held up as being like food experts.
Yeah,
and they've almost become where they can't enjoy anything unless it's super expensive or prepared in a particular way, so that they aren't able to receive from everyone.
Yeah.
They,
uh-huh.
Unless it's been up to their standards, it's garbage to them.
That's right.
But the Lord doesn't have any snobbery in the kingdom. Receiving with thanksgiving, it completely takes out of the equation fleshly ability, like their eloquence of speech or things like that. Like someone might say, well, so and so doesn't use enough salt when they're cooking, so I can't eat their food because it doesn't taste very good. Well, if you receive with thanksgiving, how a person speaks, and it is important to speak well so that people can understand you, but you don't need to use the biggest words, and you just speak what the Lord has given you.
That's right.
And the Lord will work through you.
That's right.
Amen.
Amen.
Now, after he blessed and break it, so he made it distributable. See, the breaking of the bread was made it distributable. He didn't just pass the loaf around, everybody broke off what they wanted.
That's right.
He distributed it to his disciples. Now there's divine management, see. He managed the distribution. He created the supply, then he just gave it to the disciples for distribution. Matthew reports he gave the loaves to his disciples. Mark says God gave them to his disciples. So Jesus again created the supply, then distributed it to his faithful laborers. In our case, he still has developed the supply. He distributed it to apostles, prophets, evangelists, pastors, teachers, see? He gives it to them for the detailed distribution. When giving the law, he gave it to Moses, and then Moses became a steward to give it to the people. This idea is confirmed in the parable of the talents and the pounds. The supply belonged to the master. He distributed it. Then they were to use what they had. They had to increase it, use it. That's still the way it is. I'll comment on more extensively on this a little later, but when we come together, Jesus, if we're all in subjection to Christ, of course, that's the that's the caveat. If you're all in subjection to Christ, Christ will prepare what's to be handed out. Then he'll distribute it to various disciples who are in turn to distribute it. See?
Yes.
And everyone's going to distribute some of this food.
Mm-hmm.
You may not have as large a portion to distribute as the next person, but everything is distributed.
And Brother Gibbon, I really appreciated your comment on this, that this all began with a very small supply.
That's right.
So you may be sitting here thinking, well, what I have is just so insignificant, but if you give it to Jesus, this is a powerful consideration.
Yeah. And what he'll do, he'll use the responses of other brethren to show you how much that was that you were given.
That's right.
You didn't realize it at the time. So the disciples, they gave it to them, and Luke here says, to them which were set down. It doesn't mean there were some standing around, but see, they were in a posture to receive the food. That's what we do. We come, when we come here, we want to be in a posture to receive from the Lord, a receiving posture. You can be in a worried posture. Something happened today could be plaguing you, you know. Thinking about it. Or maybe it had been a report you've listened to, made the mistake of listening to the weatherman before you came. See, there's other things. You've got to be set in a posture to receive. And how much did they receive? As much as they wanted. That's the New King James Version. As much as they had need of. That's the basic Bible, according to their appetite. The only limitation was their appetite.
Yes,
amen. Their size wasn't a limitation, their age wasn't a limitation, their job wasn't a limitation, just their appetite. That was the only limitation.
Amen.
It's still that way.
Amen.
When it comes to receiving the things of God, your only limitation is your spiritual appetite.
Mm-hmm.
It's the degree to which you're hungry and thirsting for righteousness. See, some people can't receive much because they're not very hungry. See? They don't really see a need to live by every word of God. That's the situation. It may not be fashionable to say that, but that's the situation. Brother Justin.
That's why it says they didn't receive a love for the truth that they might be
saved. That's right. Mm-hmm. That's right. And the disciples had to ensure that everyone is in a proper... They weren't going out there throwing it out in the field to someone who's wandering out in the field and they pitched a loaf out to him. That's not how it was.
Mm-hmm.
They had to see to it that everyone had sufficient to eat, that nobody was still hungry.
Yeah. Mm-hmm.
Now, I don't know of any restaurant that operates on this basis, unless it's a buffet.
Yeah.
But the normal restaurant doesn't operate. Are you full now?
Uh-huh.
you ordered a T-bone, you know, say, are you full? No, I'm not full. We'll bring you another one. But that's the way this was said. That's the way this was handed out. The thorough distribution for everyone, everybody to be filled and satisfied. Jesus, of course, didn't want someone leaving his teaching and leaving his ministry saying, you know, what they saved didn't serve very much there. They fed us, but we're frankly used to eating a little bit more than that. See, nobody said that when Jesus fed them.
I'm really giving you just confronted with someone who was told by the leadership in the church that when you come here on Sunday, you should not expect to be fed because we haven't met to eat, we've met to
praise.
Now, that about floored me when I read that. It's like,
You
shouldn't be expected to eat when you come to the assembly. Oh,
they left. They left, but that's what they were told. They were rebuked. See, they asked for more nourishment. Uh-huh. And they said, you don't come here to be fed. We come here to praise. Yeah. And I don't think they probably did a very good job at that either.
But Jesus feeds people.
He sure does. Amen. And when they were filled, see, the Holy Spirit makes sure this is written. When they were filled, and not until they were filled, he said to his disciples, gather up the fragments that remain. So the distribution, you get the picture, it continued. The disciples kept passing among the multitude, distributing the food till everybody was filled up. That had to be, the disciples had to be discerning. See, they couldn't just be doing this haphazardly. Matthew reports they did all eat and were filled. Matthew 14:20. Mark and Luke report the same thing, that they were filled. The text says the disciples set before the people as much as they wanted. So I get the picture, came to this group of people and he set out a supply that could obviously supply everything that everybody in that handful of people wanted. Now this, you can see where we're going with this, but this is still how it has to be when the people of God are fed. So they kept on eating, until their capacity had been reached. No diets here. There are no diets in the kingdom of God.
Amen.
In the world there are diets, but not in the kingdom of God. Well, not in the kingdom of God. You can eat till you're full. Fill yourself up with fat things.
Amen.
Wine on the lees. Feast of fat things. So they kept on eating until their capacity was reached. They were focused upon eating at this time. Their mind wasn't thinking about something else. They're thinking on eating. So they kept eating until their capacity was reached. They took advantage, full advantage of what the Lord had supplied. The Lord had supplied as much as they needed, as much as they desired, as much as they wanted. They took advantage of that.
Yeah.
Now we try and do this. We don't claim to be experts in this, but we're working at this more and more. To have every assembly to have enough in it so that everybody can be filled, not so that everybody can have a little. That's how the world thinks. So at least everybody can have a little something anyway. A little.
Yeah.
That's not the way God doesn't operate like that. The same type of things characterize spiritual consumption. If at any legitimate gathering of the flock of God, everyone is to be fed as much as they can receive.
Amen, that's right. Yes.
Yeah, we might be here a long time, so be it.
Yeah, that's right.
Do you think these people were thinking of a short time or cutting the time short?
Mm-hmm.
When you know you have a supply like that, you're not going to be looking for some reason to cut the meeting short.
That's right.
Yeah.
That's right.
Amen.
You know, when you go to McDonald's and go to the drive-thru, you don't stay long. But when you go to Red Lobster, you don't get up and just run out of the room.
That's right.
You're there for the long haul.
That's right. See, the great, Sister Maddie.
Technically, Jesus he had the ability to just miraculously fill their bellies. But He's showing something here about participation.
That's right.
And how you have to yourself reach out your hand and receive and eat the things that are given to you, or you won't receive the benefit of it.
That's right. I think we can safely say that it's, the nature of Jesus is not to fill people's belly. Himself. Because of this participation thing.
Yeah.
If you're going to be filled, the only thing you can be filled with that you don't yourself produce is the Holy Spirit. When it comes to your food, you've got to ingest.
That's right.
Ingest it. Jesus is the great shepherd of the sheep, and one of the primary functions of a shepherd is to feed. Now, I don't know why this isn't known. There are some people that to this day think the primary work of the shepherd is to find the lost sheep. See, the fold's the main thing. That's where the shepherd brought that sheep. The sheep left the fold.
Yeah, that's right.
This wasn't a Muslim out there. I think people need to face texts like this and chuck their tradition down the drain. It was a sheep that had left the fold.
Yes.
He went out and found it and brought it back to the fold. The Lord is interested in that fold. He's the great shepherd of the sheep. Those who have no appetite for the things of God will not relish what Jesus is serving up. And you should not try and make them relish it. We're dissatisfied that anyone doesn't want what Jesus gives, but we are not unwise. We know we can't give them a good appetite. We'll pray for them, we'll do our best, but we're not going to dumb things down to please them. And we see any given assembly conducted in an orderly and profitable manner, as though all of the participants met together to ensure a good orchestration of contributions. See, we come together because the shepherd, he's developed the meal, and he's going to, the full meal, he's going to make distribution of the a full supply. So when we meet together, everybody, in a sense, is going to become a distributor.
Yeah.
And we meet together in anticipation of that. Some people are legitimate people of God, but they just have never been taught this. They haven't seen it. They come together just to hear, you know, what the main speaker says. And that's, we don't despise that, because Jesus was the main speaker, and you better come to hear what he says.
Yeah.
But in an assembly of God's development, the bulk is distributed by various members of the body.
Yeah.
Those who have no appetite for it will just be left out. Now, Peter says, if any man speak, let him speak as the oracles of God. 1 Peter 4:11. An oracle is a saying or a word. It's like a fragment, like a piece of bread or a piece of fish. It's not the whole. Oracles aren't the whole. They're a part. If any man speak, you speak something that fits into the whole.
Yeah.
You've got like a piece of the puzzle that fits in
with
the overall thing that God is teaching the people. If you're going to speak as someone that's speaking, that's distributing a piece of the fish that Jesus multiplied.
That's right. Amen.
And a piece of the bread that Jesus multiplied.
That's right.
That's something to think about, isn't it?
Yes, it is.
Now, Jesus says to them, they've all filled now. This must have taken a while. He said, now, gather up the fragments that remain. Gather up the broken pieces that remain over that nothing be lost. American Standard Version. We're not going to let, see, while they're eating, some dropped, you know, and maybe the children ate and dropped some little pieces of bread and fish. Gather it up. You may recall it when the Passover lamb, when they ate the Passover lamb, God gave them some instructions. He said, now, if the household be too little for the lamb, let him and his neighbor next to his house, Mm-hmm. Go over there and say, look, we not got enough people for this lamb here. Uh-huh. Get next to his house, take it according to the number of the souls. Mm-hmm. Every man according to his eating shall make your count. Make your count mm-hmm. for the lamb. So they look at the lamb and say, this is good for 15 people. Counted up the house, told me the service, we only got 13. All right. Got to go next door and say, look, mm-hmm. we not got enough people to consume all this mm-hmm. lamb, so you join with us so that there be no waste. Mm-hmm. Then he told him, let nothing remain. That included this carcass. Mm-hmm. Let nothing remain until the morning, and that which remaineth of it until the morning ye should burn with fire. See, mm-hmm. the whole thing has got to be eaten. And whatever is not consumable, which I assume was the skin and the carcasses, or they burn it outside the camp. Mm-hmm. Now, it's my persuasion that God intends mm-hmm. that what he makes known is to be understood.
Yeah, amen.
Is to be received and to be understood. Sometimes you'll have to work at it. I understand this. I have to work at it myself. But he intends, if God gives the food, it's intended to be eaten.
Yeah, amen.
And if it's not eaten, we gather up the fragments that there be no waste. The remaining fragments are over and above unto them that had eaten. It's just what they couldn't consume it. Now, who's able to measure how much has been set before the people that hasn't been consumed? I mean, you. Sometimes I can sense a little bit of it, but you can't spill it out. You can sense more has been said here than I immediately see. What are we going to do? We're going to gather up the fragments. We're going to make sure that we have some way to keep what was said. That's what we do, and we have comments after participation. That's what we're doing. We're gathering up the fragments that there be no waste.
Yeah, amen.
You may have seen something that the rest of us didn't see.
Mm-hmm.
So you gather up the fragments that nothing be lost. Well, nothing to be lost. Oh, this will transform what the world calls church attendance. This will transform it. I intend to receive everything that's said. Now, some places it won't be much of a challenge. It's sad to report that, but some places you really don't have to. You could receive pretty much everything that's said, and sometimes some of it must not be received. But God's not sparse. He is not sparse. He does not serve skimpy meals, not Jesus. And when his people come together, he does not serve just like hors d'oeuvres.
Yeah, that's right.
That's not what Jesus does. He sets a spread out, a feast of fat things, and wine on the least. He sets that table so everybody can eat, because you're in a war. You're a soldier, see?
Yeah.
You're a soldier. You got to eat. You're a runner.
Mm-hmm.
You got to eat. You're a builder.
Yeah.
You got to eat. See? So this isn't just to increase our base of knowledge. It'll do that, but we're talking about survival and spiritual aptitude here.
Amen.
These people had to make it back to where they came from. Mm-hmm. Some of them came out of cities that were a long way away. They had to make it back. And Jesus made it so they didn't have to buy food on the way. Now, I will make this statement that a considerable amount of backsliding, returning to the world from which we were delivered and departing from the faith, a lot of that is owing to spiritual malnutrition.
Yes. Mm-hmm.
A lot of that doesn't happen because the people just were rebels.
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm.
It's because they were too weak. They hadn't been given enough to eat.
Yeah, amen.
Mm-hmm. And whoever didn't give them enough to eat are going to answer for that. The day of judgment, now this is going to be brought up. These people were in your care,
yeah.
and you served up these skimpy meals, and I've examined the people from your church, Pastor Blowhard, I've examined the people from your church, and they're all weak and emaciated. That's your fault. And on the other hand, if someone's strong, they'll be rewarded for being faithful, faithful servants. So don't be among those that simply don't eat enough. That's one of the dangers of an entertainment-crazed society. This is one of the dangers. There's too many other things you can give your attention to, see? And you may say, well, it's not nothing against it in the Bible. Well, I understand that, but that's not the way you should think. There is things in the Bible against a mind that's not developed properly, and a heart that's not filled properly, and a person not dedicated enough. There is something about that in the Scriptures. And you rest assured that in salvation, the common salvation, as Jude would call it, the common salvation, everything you need to please God and to be sustained is included in that salvation.
Amen.
And it is accessible
by
your faith. You can obtain it by your faith. Everything God has provided, all things pertain to life and to godliness, is attainable by your faith.
Amen.
And if I had the power, I'd convince you of that, but I think some of you already know this, but it's good to know, isn't it?
Yes.
You don't have to shop anywhere else.
Yeah.
All right, I think I'm going to close there. Any of you have a word, Brother Ricky?
Yeah, isn't it interesting that they start with 5 loaves, but they gather up 12 baskets? The source actually increased.
It increased.
Although it was distributed.
That's right. Yeah.
So it didn't diminish as would normally take place.
Amen.
It actually increased. And that's the way Kingdom Resources is. That's a demonstration of abundance.
Amen.
Think of all the grace that has been dispensed from the beginning of time, and yet it's not gone down at all.
No.
And that's just the way all of His Kingdom Resources are. We never have to be concerned that we have to skimp around with the resources because they never diminish.
Amen. I think if we were to at random just pick out somebody here, has been here for a while, and go back a few years, and then you would actually experience how you were back then, you would be astounded at how far you've come.
Yes.
So you wouldn't be questioning miracles, I'll tell you that.
Yeah.
Yes, brother.
Yeah. I was thinking, well, same thing as Brother Ricky, but in the kingdom of God, it's like it looks small and then it expands. But then, other way, some people have given themselves to the devil, thinking it looks big and it looks we're going to get a lot here.
Yeah,
leaving God, thinking this is really going to benefit me, and in the end, it wasn't what
that's
it
right.
looked like.
That's right.
It diminished, and it left you worse off.
That's right.
The kingdom of God may look small to you, and then as you get closer, it's bigger, and you are benefited by it.
Amen.
Yeah.
Yeah, a billion sounds like a lot, but when Jesus comes, it'll be instantly removed.
That's right. Yeah.
I could go to the movie theater tonight, and I could watch a movie, and then the next day watch that same movie, and I probably wouldn't be impressed with it.
Mm-hmm.
But tonight, well, the things that were spoken here tonight, you can listen to that MP3 tomorrow.
Yeah. Yeah.
Tomorrow on SoundCloud.
Get more.
And it would be totally different. You
That's
would get
right.
more out
get
of
more.
It.
That's right.
You
That's
would
right.
get more out of it.
It tends to multiply.
That's right.
Yeah.
It tends to multiply.
That's right.
Yeah.
If you had an orphanage, and it was a big write-up in the paper that all the funds that you received to buy food for the children, you just used on yourself, and you had them sit around the table and chant. But see, they would put you in prison for neglect. But see, churches don't have a problem with this. Most churches don't have a problem with malnutrition in the pews. I don't even know if they realize it. I don't even know if they see the sense of they've got to be fed if they're going to be strong.
Yeah.
And yet, see, in the physical world, we would all, it would be an outcry. It'd be like, what are you doing to these poor kids? But see, that doesn't transfer over to the church. It's just like, well, you know, you got a Bible, get out there and figure it out. But that isn't how the procedure that you outlined today shows you that God is involved in the whole process.
Yeah.
He started it. He gave it to Jesus, as it were.
Yeah. Yeah.
Jesus gives it to faithful ministers, and then, or the Holy Spirit. The Holy Spirit gets, however you want to look at, but it's available.
That's right.
There's no excuse. There's nothing saying,
right.
Well, I just didn't understand enough. This boy only had a little lunch.
Yeah.
And it fed 5,000 men. So, I mean, this is no excuse.
He probably got to eat more than he had in his lunch.
I think
so.
Amen.
Yes.
Yeah, I've got a fragment to gather up. You know, with a group of 10 or 15 or 20,000 people, there's probably some people rumbling about, when am I going to get my thing to eat? And a lot of those people, if not most of them, were non-believers, so they wouldn't really know what was going to happen.
Mm-hmm.
But Jesus commands patience.
Yeah.
Mm-hmm. Right? He teaches us to wait, that when the Lord, when He has things to do, it's going to be done on His schedule,
yeah,
in His time,
mm-hmm,
and we're to be patient.
Amen.
Yeah.
Mm-hmm.
Mm-hmm. Yeah. Amen.
Mm-hmm.
I never noticed this phrase, over and above unto them that had eaten. I never noticed that before. But I was actually thinking the same thing as Brother Ricky was, and I guess Brother Jeremy too, is that they ended up with so much more than they started with, that it keeps you coming back for more.
Yeah.
It's not when you eat one time, wow, look at all the leftovers, and then you don't come back to take care of those leftovers. Because I know at least in our house, if we have leftovers after dinner, 2 or 3 days down the line, they're going to get eaten too.
Mm-hmm.
They're going to be enjoyed just as much as the initial meal,
yeah,
was.
Yeah.
So all these leftovers that you have from a meeting or from studying the scriptures, you can come back to them. Like Brother Justin was saying, you can always come back to them, and they're never going to be old.
Yeah.
They're never going to be stale either,
yeah,
because food,
right,
can do that. Food can go stale, and you don't want to eat it anymore. But that's not the way these fragments are.
Hmm.
They're over and above, but that's so that you can come back to them.
That's right.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah.
Amen. Notice here that it says that fill the 12 baskets with the fragments of the 5 barley loaves, a remembrance of how small it started.
That's right.
It says that. The scripture tells us not to despise,
yes,
the day of small things.
That's right.
Sometimes it's
advantageous,
right,
to think back on what it was when we couldn't see what God was going to do,
yeah,
and then see what it became.
Amen.
That's right. Amen.
Amen.
Mm-hmm. Now, I enjoy this word about not wasting what's left, because, well, it's pretty clear this wasn't like gathered up for the trash heap, so to speak.
Mm-hmm.
All right, everyone's done now. Let's just toss it, you know. I mean, in a sense, those remnants, those things that remain, we need those things.
Mm-hmm.
These are things we have to store up, because later we're going to need those same things.
That's right.
So,
mm-hmm,
yeah, it's not so much, yeah, I appreciate it doesn't denigrate quality or whatnot. We think of leftovers that way, but this is what, I mean, it couldn't be. There was no capacity left in the crowd to eat.
Mm-hmm.
Out of this small amount.
Only save the bread.
Yeah.
Yes.
They didn't pick up any fish because the fish wouldn't keep. You're right. It was saved for later time.
Yeah.
If they would have just gathered the fish, that would have gone bad quickly. It would have been for the heat, but it was for later.
Yes, Brother Gene.
The Lord didn't ask the people what they wanted to eat. Some of us have experienced that. Some of us have even tried it. I tried it in the past, as people. They didn't even know. Nobody even had a suggestion. And yet,
yeah,
some would complain.
Mm.
Yeah.
Yeah, some would complain. Some complain,
yeah,
said, you're not giving me what I want.
Mm.
Yeah.
But they didn't have any... They didn't have any suggestions about what,
yeah,
they wanted.
That's right. They didn't know.
Like,
yeah,
like little children.
Mm-hmm.
Just,
yeah,
like little children.
Just something.
And, yeah, something different than what you're giving.
Yeah.
That's
right.
Yeah.
Yeah, Sister Barb.
A lot of times when the Lord teaches us, we quickly realize that it's not long before we have to employ what we learned.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah.
From the lesson that He taught.
That's right.
And I was considering the timing of this miracle. with bread. Very soon, Jesus is about to open up who he is.
Mm-hmm.
He's going to tell them that he is the bread.
That's right.
Yeah. Amen.
Very mm-hmm. shortly after this takes place,
after this, that's right.
The teaching of these things about the abundance
mm-hmm.
and about the nourishing and about the unlimited Amen. Availability mm-hmm. to the desire,
mm-hmm.
he's getting ready to teach them about himself
yeah.
being
the Yes,
bread.
Amen.
Amen.
Yeah. Yeah, I've been thinking a lot about this, but I would have been really difficult for me, I think, if I would have been strong and healthy and vibrant and the hospital said, we don't want you no more. But see, God, first of all, he got me weak and he got me to where I couldn't do the work. And then the hospital worked.
Mm-hmm.
And it made sense that God's given me a break. Now, I'm not giving up, but I'm saying God got me ready for it.
Yeah, that's right.
The same thing with these fragments. See, he's now they have a desire for it. Now that you know they've tasted it, and so it's not garbage. They know it's good. Anyway, God gets us ready.
Amen.
Amen.
All right, I better quit there, Sister Barb.